The brand Audi is no stranger to success in motorsport. However, some of the history of Audi's racing successes are quite unique, particularly with their involvement in the Trans-AM and IMSA GTO series. And we're here with Timo from Audi Tradition to find out a little bit more about the history of these two cars in particular. So Timo, first of all, for a European manufacturer competing initially in 1988 in the Trans-AM series with a small capacity five-cylinder engine against some larger capacity, much bigger V8s. How difficult was that to compete on an even playing field?
I think it wasn't, the competition itself wasn't so easy, so difficult back in the days, because I think the approach of everything was the higher difficulty in these cases, because just to see and to find out for the competitors to see that this small capacity engine can match the other engine, and because of the turbocharged technology and whatever, I think this was quite a waking up moment for everybody, and I think there was a lot of trust inside the development department from Audi to see that we can match these numbers, which the other competitors in the US can do with the bigger engines.
Okay, now talking about the turbocharger setup, so this is a small capacity 2.1 litre engine versus the much bigger naturally aspirated V8s you're competing against. What sort of power level were these Audis running in Trans-AM form?
You mean the power output of the engine? It was 550 horsepower with roughly a boost level of about like 2.1 bars. In competition, maybe a little bit higher, depends on the ambient conditions, I think.
Now, sort of that power level these days is something we're seeing in just everyday driven street cars, so definitely nothing too out of the ordinary in 2019. However, back in 1988, getting these sort of numbers out of a small capacity engine was no easy task, and particularly turbocharger technology wasn't as advanced. So was it a problem getting a usable power band at that sort of power level from a 2.1 litre engine?
I don't think so. I think the challenge is always with turbocharged engine to find the right ratio on the exhaust side and on the intake side, just to have a nice power delivery at a certain rev point, of course. But the task was to find this particular setup for racing, and this is a little bit easier because others as in rallies, as we did, what we did before, where you need a wide range of power and torque to be delivered to match to the driver and to make the car drivable even better. In racing, it's a little bit easier, I would say, because you're just revving on a certain amount of rev range, so the setup of the turbocharger just needs to match this particular rev range. You know what I mean? So that you just end up on the right area with a turbocharger and whatever.
So essentially much more difficult to get a usable power band for rallying because you're over such a dynamic range of the revs. And also I think it's fair to say with circuit racing, you're obviously going around the same track lap after lap. The driver knows what gear and what RPM range he's going to be in for each corner, whereas rallying is much more dynamic. You're coming around a blind corner over a crest, and sometimes you find yourself you're in the wrong gear. So that's where for the rallying the anti-lag was so important, but not critical or not an issue for circuit racing.
That's right, it wasn't critical.
Okay, so after the Trans-AM development, Audi moved into the IMSA GTO series. Could you just talk to us a little bit about the difference between Trans-AM and the IMSA series, or the specification of the car, I should say?
Yes, it was. The IMSA series itself basically was combined together with the Trans-AM series as well. So they were basically in the same kind of competition, but in a different class. Mm-hmm. So Audi started in 1988 just to push the sales and the market a little bit in the US. They decided to go into the US market and racing because they want to have a better sales margin. So they tried to find the right competition level. So they started with Trans-AM on first side. The Trans-AM basically is based on a production car, the metal, the body, metal, the
chassis.
The chassis is based on the production car, and also the silhouette of the car has to match the kind of the production car which this car was based on. So, and then you do the standard work as you do on a racing car. You put a roll cage inside and decide what kind of packaging you want to do. but this was for the Trans-Am series. And the level higher was the IMSA series. And maybe later we can look inside the chassis and see the difference just on the camera as well. The IMSA car has a tub inside, as modern racing cars do have, and then you have a welded roll cage and a metal frame just to match the bodywork parts. And even the regulation said that the whole components do not need to match to the production as much as they did on the Trans-Am side.
So essentially breaking that down, Trans-Am very closely based on a production road car and a lot more limited in what you could do because of that, whereas when you move to IMSA, a lot more freedom. Really, it's not a production road car anymore. It's just in basic, if you look at it, the silhouette form is the same as the road car, and that's about where it finishes.
Generally speaking, I would agree what you just said. But for example, if we combine a Trans-Am car to a standard touring car, a standard touring car is even closer to the production car. A Trans-Am is a little bit wider on the regulation, but still closer to the production as an IMSA car is, of course.
Stepping into IMSA, was there any further development to the engine? Was there any more power needed to be competitive?
Yes, because with the change of regulation, it was a far more competitive car. So there were some modifications to the engine, as there were some modifications to the whole car as well.
Yeah. What sort of power level did you get up to?
Up to 720 horsepower in racing.
Yeah. And what sort of boost pressure were you using to achieve that?
Almost 3 bars.
Running 3 bar into any engine is going to give you some challenges, but when you're trying to do it over the course of a race and maintain reliability, that's even more tricky, particularly in terms of the head ceiling. Is there anything tricky that was being done with the engine in order to maintain reliability at that boost level?
Yes, basically the engine was based quite a bit on the Rally Group B engine we had in the S1 E2 car. It was a 4-valve engine. If you compare that to the Trans-Am car, it was a 2-valve engine, by the way. And with the 4-valve engine, there was a change in the cylinder head as well, and also on the cylinder head cover. But I think one of the big design points of that engine is that you have a stud running through from the cylinder head through the crankcase down to the crankshaft housing, just to fix it all together and just to match the boost pressure you have or the combustion pressure you get on the engine once you're running with such a high boost of turbo power.
So you're running that stud all the way from the top of the head right down into the caps for the crankshaft and essentially clamping the whole engine together in order to achieve head gasket sealing?
Yes, you do. You clamp it all together. Yeah.
Now, another aspect with the Audi that obviously was one of the keys to the success was the four-wheel drive system. And in the IMSA series, were any other competitors four-wheel drive?
No, it was just Audi running four-wheel drive on the system. And as far as I know, later on it was forbidden as well.
Yeah, my understanding is after the 1989 season, that was the end of four-wheel drive. So is that an advantage with the sort of power level on a dry racetrack, or was it only really an advantage to Audi when it was wet?
No, I think it was generally an advantage, like accelerating out of corners, slow corners as well. We were talking about power response. This is one thing, but the other thing is if you have a power response, you need traction as well. And this is what was clearly an advantage for the Quattro cars.
Now, just reaching back into the deep, dim recesses of my memory, if I recall correctly, at the start of the 89 IMSA season, there were a couple of rounds missed, but beyond that, Audi were relatively dominant, but just missed out on a championship season because of the rounds that were missed. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct, because I think the decision to change from Trans-Am to IMSA was done in a very short sight, and, you know, 88 Trans-Am, 89 IMSA was, in summary, 2 cars for 2 years. So there was a very small development time, and they were not really done with the development beginning of the year. So they decided to miss their, like, Sebring, the longer distance races, and the first 3 races were missed. Or we missed the first 3 races because of development time and just to be sure that the car will last the race and this is everything is developed in a good, proper way. And this is the reason why at the end of the day, at the end of the season, the success was not enough just to win the championship. They became third.
maybe just a case of what could have been, but of course then the rules were changed and four-wheel drive was banned. Now, just want to talk a little bit about the electronics technology, because again, the late 80s, it's a long time ago now, we've seen massive advances, particularly in the electronic technology. And again, trying to control an engine producing that sort of power level is tricky even these days. So can you talk to us about the ECU controlling the engine and how that operated, what sort of functionality you had there?
It was basically a Bosch Motorsport engine ECU on two cars, on both cars, sorry. It's a Bosch MP 1.2 on the Trans-AM car and a Bosch MP 1.7 on the IMSA car. Both of them obviously controlling boost pressure, boost regulation. Other than that, we have a second gallery of fuel injection on the IMSA car. This was just a specific thing, I think, for the IMSA car. I don't know how likely it was back in the days to have it on other cars. Sure, on racing, having a turbocharged engine on racing was not so common as it was nowadays. So this was, if you would say it like this, a little bit particular, but in general it was a standard racing ECU, which in ref and throttle profile, you know, throttle angle profile.
Okay, so basically pretty standard stuff there for the engine management. In this time, was there a focus on data logging as well for looking after the engine and improving both the chassis, engine and driver performance?
Very, very basic, I would say. There was a data logging also, but at the end of the day, you were able to read the max values, what you've reached. So in terms of overlaying graphs and whatever, it was not that sophisticated as it was nowadays, obvious, of course. And I think one of the most important points was still, what did the driver say? You know, listening to the driver. And also just to find out if you're looking for a problem or a mistake, then you can maybe have a little bit of data logging available, but just basic figures, far away from being sophisticated as it is nowadays, of course.
Is it safe to assume as well, absolutely no driver aids back in these days, no traction control, no launch control?
No, nothing of this, just standard racing.
A purer time, maybe relying just a touch more on sheer driver skill rather than electronic intervention. Look, Timo, great to chat and find out a little bit more about these cars. Thanks for your time there.
Thank you, my pleasure.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.